Hello out there. Hello TV viewers. This is Pastor Ayodele Awe. God bless you. Before we get into today's teaching, let's say a short prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, dear Holy Spirit, I just thank you for everyone listening. As I speak today, Lord, I ask you to bring healing. I ask you to bring peace. I ask you to bring understanding to everyone that's listening to me. Through me, Lord, I ask you to speak through me. Let your Holy Spirit, bless your people as I speak in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord, TV viewers. My name is Pastor Ayodele Awe. Today I'm going to be teaching on living the blessings of God. So basically, I'm going to be talking about how to live a blessed life, even in a failing economy. How to be blessed in famine. And we're going to be looking at a teaching from the book of, I'm going to be taking my anchor scripture from Luke chapter 5. I'm going to be reading from verse 1 through 8. Luke chapter 5 from verse 1 through 8. I've been getting a lot of calls, and most of my friends, most of the people that I know that I speak to, we necessarily don't even talk, not all my friends I talk about church, or God. But when I speak to people, one thing I see that is very, very prevalent, people talking about is their finances, how can God bless me? People are very interested in anything that has to do with money. So last week, one of my Christian partners called me and said, Pastor, I want you to pray for me. He said, I want you to pray for me that God will bless me. He said, I want you to pray for me that, I will be a millionaire. She said, I want to be a very, very successful person. So I had to go through scriptures and I had to say, my sister, I said, my brother, I said, the things of God's kingdom operate by principles. The things of the kingdom operate by principles, and the blessings of God does not just come by prayer, it comes by engaging the principles of God. So we're going to be looking at Luke chapter 5 just to get, a snapshot of one of these principles, and it's the principles of, of giving. But let's if you have your Bible, read along with me and also what the Bible says. Now Jesus was going around, he was teaching, and in Luke chapter 5 he says, it was as the multitude pressed about to hear the word of God. Jesus was preaching, and there was a crowd, and this was a multitude. I say, and they pressed. Pressed means they wanted to hear, they wanted to know. They pressed to hear the word of God. It said, he stood by the lake of Gennesaret. Jesus stood by the lake of Gennesaret. It says, and saw two boats standing by the lake. But the fishermen had gone from them and were washing their nets. So there were two boats by the lake, and the fishermen had gone from them washing their net. When the fishermen are washing their net, that means like they were done. They were done fishing. There were no more fishing. They were done pretty much for that day. And verse 3 says, he got into one of the boats, which was Simon. Jesus got into Simon's boat and asked him to put out a little from the land. He sat down and taught the multitudes from the boat. So Jesus sat down, and now, he got into Peter's boat and started to teach Peter from, the boat of Peter. The Bible now says, when he had stopped speaking, Jesus stood. And when he finished, he said to Simon, launch out into the deep and let your nets for a catch. Remember I said, there were two boats. These fishermen were done. One of them was Simon Peter. When he was done, he had given up. Then Jesus got into his boat. He taught the multitudes from the boat. When he taught the multitudes from the boat, when Jesus was now done, Jesus now says, okay, Peter, launch out into the deep and let your net for a catch. Let your net for a catch. Simon Peter answered him and said, he said, Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. He says, Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. He says, nevertheless, at your word, I will let down the net. We're going to read this, and I'm going to go back, and we're going to, you know, talk about the principle. You know, Simon said, "Say, Master, we've been here all night. You know, we only that fished from midnight all the way through the night, through the morning, through the afternoon." He said, "We have toiled all night and caught nothing." He said, "Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down the net." So this must have been a very frustrated fisherman. You know, Simon Peter, you know, how do you go to work? You know, you have been in this business, this venture, all night, all day. He said, we'll be here all night. I caught nothing. But he says, but at your word, I will let down the net. He said, when they had done this, now this is another principle here. When they had done this, what did they do? They obeyed. Obedience. That is another key. They obeyed what Jesus told them to do. They caught a great number of fish, and their net was breaking. Their net was breaking means they got excess fish. Being around Jesus, the miracle worker, he cast out the net. In the natural, when he tried to do it by himself, nothing happened. But when he partnered with Jesus, Jesus used his boat. He now let that net into the sea. When he did that, he said there was a great number of fish. Their net was breaking. Look at what happened in verse 7. They signaled their partners. Remember, they had other partners, joint fishermen, fishing together. They signaled their partners in the other boats to come and help them. And they came and filled both the boats, and they began to sink. Oh my God. Frustrated fishermen, all of a sudden, Jesus gave them instructions. They obeyed. They cast out the net. This time, there was excessive fish. Peter could not pull by himself. He could not contain the blessings of God that came as a result of obedience. He now, Peter had to say, oh, fellow fishermen, come. Please come and help me. You see what happens when God decides to bless you? You can't contain the blessing by yourself. God decides to bless Peter for his obedience. And Peter now begins to signal his partner. He says, come and help me, please. This fish is even trying to pull Peter back in the water. Why? That is excessive blessing. He now begins to call his other fishing partners. He says, come and help me. And they all began to pull together. But their nets even began to break. It began to crack. Why? It was too much fish. The Bible says, when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' feet, saying from me, depart from me, for I'm a sinful man, O Lord. He said that because he knew that, obviously, this was a miracle. This was not possible by his natural means, because he had tried so much, and he had never, probably had never caught this amount of fish since he started fishing. So he knew that there was something about Jesus. The Bible says in verse 9, for he and all who were at him were astonished. For he and all who were with him were astonished at the catch of fish for which they had taken. And so also were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, do not be afraid. He said, from now on, you will catch men. The Bible says they now brought their boats to the land, and they forsook all and followed him. Wow, I've never seen that. The Bible says they, not just Simon Peter, they forsook all. When they came back to land, they brought their boats to the land. They forsook all and followed him. They left all when they saw the miracle, and they followed Jesus. Now let's go back again. We're going to look at, what were the principles? What are the things that happened here? First of all, from this story, Jesus has started his teaching ministry, his ministry. Jesus was going around, you know, preaching, teaching the people. Now this time there was a crowd that came. trying to hear the word of God. They were pressing to hear the word of God. There was a big crowd. Jesus was standing by the lake, and he was teaching those people. While Jesus was teaching them, there was a crowd. And Jesus now looked. The Bible says there were two boats around. One of them belonged to Simon Peter. Remember Peter in the Bible? His first name was Simon. Simon Peter. Jesus now got into Simon's boat. And he started to teach the people from Simon's boat. Before Jesus got into Simon's boat, the Bible said they were already washing their nets. Washing their nets means that they were done for the day. They were ready to go home. They hadn't caught any fish. In fact, it was a really, really bad and terrible day. Bad day for business. Bad day for business. Maybe out of life, you've just gone through life and everything is just frustrating. You're frustrated. Simon must have been very, very frustrated because he didn't catch anything. His business was going down. I'm sure he had debts to pay, his bills. Simon must have been like, oh my God, what am I going to tell my wife today? I don't even know if he had a wife. But what am I going to tell the family? Maybe that's your situation. No catch, nothing. But Jesus got into his boat. And Jesus began to use Simon's boat for Jesus' business. What was Jesus' business? Teaching the gospel, preaching the gospel, reaching the lost, reaching God's people. The Bible now said, when Jesus was now done, he now told Simon, he says, launch into the deep and let down your net for a catch. He says, okay, Simon, it's now time for me to bless you. You have given me your boat. You have given me something. You have given me your business. Simon had sown a seed into the ministry of Jesus Christ. And Jesus began to teach. Simon answered and said, he said, Master, I've been here all night, so I'm a professional fisherman. Your business is preaching. This business, fish business, that's what I'm a professional fisherman for over 30 years. Forget how long. He said, but I've been here. Oh. He said, there's no fish in this water. That's what Simon said. He said, there's no fish here. I've looked and looked and looked and looked. In fact, it's a bad season. But he now said, but because you say so, probably you're the son of God. I know you're the son of God. Let me just try. He did it with unbelief. And he cast his net into the sea. Simon cast his net into the sea. And the Bible now says, when they had done this, what happened? There was an explosion of a miracle. Simon was surprised. He began to pull. And the nets were like very, very hard. He couldn't even pull easily. Oh my God. The fishes begin to pull Simon. Simon begins to signal his partners. He says, come. Come into the water. Bring your boat. Come and help me. Pull those fishes. The Bible says they began to sink. Now, let's look at the principles one by one again. Simon became blessed. Simon's dying business turned around. There was a turnaround for Simon's situation. Simon Peter, I prefer to call him Peter. His business turned around. What was failing before, took flight. What did Simon do? People see the blessing. Simon was blessed by Jesus Christ. What did Simon do before Jesus blessed him? Before God blessed him? The Bible says, first of all, the people were interested in hearing the things about the word of God. Sometimes people want to be blessed. I talk to a lot of them. They want to be blessed, but they don't want to hear the word of God. No. There is blessing that comes through hearing the word of God. The word of God will teach us on how to be blessed. Amen? So it's like trying to fly a plane without going to piloting school or school of aviation. You have to take the training first before you become a professional pilot. So if you're going to be blessed by God, you still need to know the things of the Word of God. Okay? Then two, point number two, which is like this real, real key. What did Simon do? Simon gave his boat to Jesus. He said, use it. Simon sowed a seed. He gave his seed to the ministry of Jesus Christ. Now, like when I said I talked, you know, talk to people, people just say, Pastor, pray for me. Pray for me that God will bless me. Pray for me that I will have a job. Pray for me that there will be a turnaround in my situation. And I said, my brother, my sister, it doesn't work like that. There are some things that the man of God can do. He can pray for you to be blessed. But there are things that God requires you yourself to do, which is what? Giving. Simon gave his boat. Simon gave something for God to walk with, for Jesus to walk with. He gave his boat. And that boat was beneficial for the ministry of Jesus Christ. When he did that, you know, then God turned around and did what? And blessed him. Now the third point, the Bible says, it says, as your word, I will let down the net. That's point number three. Point number three after giving is obedience. Obedience. Jesus never forced Simon. Jesus didn't say, oh, I must use your boat. But Jesus just made a request. And Simon said, I don't really believe, oh, but I will obey what you say. When we obey God, God turns around and blesses us. What is obedience? Obedience simply means doing the things that God wants you to do. Doing the things that we know is right before God. When you obey God, obedient, God will bless you. Obedience is the prerequisite to the blessing of God. When God says, my son, I don't want you to do this. When you obey God, God will give you a blessing. We must obey God first. We cannot live in disobedience and expect the blessings of God. You look at the nation today. Today, you know, the fourth blood moon, you know, it came out, you know, talking about it, you know, at night. Well, that is a signal. You know, in the school of the prophetic, they say that is a signal that maybe something wants to happen. I pray nothing happens. But when we disobey God as a nation or as a people, it is responsible for the thing, negative things that happen. But when we obey, like Simon did, that is a prerequisite for blessing. So disobedience leads to curse, but obedience leads to blessing. So the Bible now says, he obeyed God. Hallelujah. When you obeyed God, the blessing of the Lord came upon Simon's life, and he was happy. Now give us the fourth point, and I want you to write this down. The fourth point, number four, be a friend of God. And I want you to write that down. Be his friend. Be a friend of God. Simon could have been like, well, whatever. I see them preaching the gospel on that end of the sea. I'm going to this side. I'm going about my business. But he didn't do that. He was involved in the things of God. He was Christ's friend. If it wasn't his friend, he wouldn't have asked him to come in his boat. When Jesus said, can I use your boat? He would have said, no. You understand? So Simon was a friend of God. He made God his friend. When you partner with the blesser is going to bless you. Who is the blesser? God. God controls every blessing on the heaven. Because heaven and earth belongs to God. So Simon Peter, he chose to be a friend of God. He didn't, you know, he didn't raise his fist at God or say, oh, there's no God. Oh, I don't believe. Oh, whatever, Jesus. You know, the same way people like, I don't believe, now people don't believe in Jesus. But, you know, but they're suffering. They're going through pain, you know, what every kind of like, you know, negative things. But Simon became a friend of God, a friend of Christ, and Christ blessed him. The fifth point, I'll say be born again. Be born again. What does born again mean? You know, you give your life over. You give your life to God. Somebody say, God, take my life and do all good things with it. Being born again means just changing our ways. Changing your ways and doing the things that, you know, the things that you used to do and they were not pleasing to God. You know, you become really sincere with yourself. Very, very sincere. You know, and you say, you know, born again means a change of heart. You know, when you become a Christian, you know, not some kind of Christians out there, you know, but the real Christian the Bible talks about, you know, God gives you a new heart. Your heart changes. You begin to see the world differently. You begin to think differently. You begin to, you know, the thing you used to do before, when God changes your heart, you know, you now know that, oh my God, you know, there's kind of like a liberation. There's like a freedom in your heart. And you become, the Bible says you become a new creature. A new creature. You begin to reason and think like Christ, like God. You know, and the Bible says it, the things I used to do before, I do them no more. I remember my old life. Oh my God. My old, when I look at some of my old life, so that's my old me. So the old me is dead now. This is the new me. Because the things I used to do before, I don't do them again. Now when I see people do them, I say, been there, done that. And I don't want to go back to that kind of life anymore. It's the same thing. God can change anybody. God can change anybody's heart. A criminal, a murderer, anybody. I've seen prostitutes, you know, come over to serve God. You know, I've seen, you know, drug addicts, you know, people with like every kind of terrible life. And when they come and God just washes them clean with the blood of Christ that was shed on the cross, and everything just changes. And then when those people, when they tell you the story, you're like, oh my God, you mean you really done that? I was listening to a great man of God that I like so much. He's real funny, Jesse Duplantis. And he was talking about in the 70s, how he used to be like a rock star. He used to be a musician, like deep rock. And you look at Jesse today. Jesse say, oh my God. He said, you don't want to see my old videos, all the videos he did when he was in the war. But Jesse will say, that was the old me. He says, the old me is dead. Well, he's a preacher today, proclaiming the gospel of Christ. God wants to do the same thing with you. He wants to change your heart, your way of living, your way of thinking. He wants to make you born again. So when you're born again, you become a candidate for his heavenly kingdom. Now, I don't know what point, maybe the seventh point now. I said, be interested in his kingdom. Be interested in the kingdom of God. People are not interested in God's kingdom anymore. People don't even care. You know, church is like the last thing on people's minds today. People don't want to go to church. Well, but they have a lot of problems. I was driving through the Berkshires yesterday, and I saw a building, a church building, and it had been changed into like an art gallery. Yeah, that's the word. They changed a church into a gallery of art. Well, I understand, why did they do that? Well, maybe the church was sitting, and the people of the town were not interested in going to church. They were not interested in the things of God. And the building begins to sit, and somebody else just, you know, like, can we have this building? And they turn God's kingdom, they turn God's church to an art gallery. Well, it shouldn't be so. Because when there's a church in a land, and that church is vibrant, doing the things of God, the people of that town will be blessed. They'll receive God's blessing, and there'll be prosperity in that town. There will be prosperity in that town, in that place. So we have to be interested in the things of God. We have to be interested in his kingdom. We have to be interested in his work. We have to be interested in the Bible. When we do that, there will be prosperity in our lives. There will be prosperity in our kingdom. There will be prosperity. You will not lose your job. You will not be sick. You know, like, look at the economy today. The economy is, you know, is shaking. You know, why? Because we are a nation that we're moving away from the things of God. We're moving away from God, you know. But God wants us to return back to him. He said, return back to me, and I will heal your land. He said, repent and return back to me, and I will heal your land. That is the word of God for America. That is the word of God for you. God says, all those stuff, all that thing that you're going through, all that trouble, all that pain, he says, return back to me, and I will heal you. Now, finally, my final point. Peter sowed a seed. He sowed a seed. He put it into Jesus' hand. His seed was his boat. And what did God do? God turned around and blessed him. Jesus turned around and blessed Peter. Remember, God the Son, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. God walking as Jesus. Peter sowed a seed, his boat, and Jesus turned around and blessed him. Maybe what God wants from you today, your seed could be yourself. Maybe God, you know, God just wants to get hold of you, and he will turn things around. He will turn things around. My friend, I want you to know that the Bible is for our profiting. Just like Peter did, you know, Peter became a disciple eventually. He left everything else and followed Jesus. God is knocking on your heart. God wants you. God wants to bless you. You have a purpose. He has a plan for your life. And that plan can only be fulfilled in full, you know, in maximum intensity when you become a child of God. Are you born again? Are you a believer? An unbeliever? Become a believer and things will turn around. And I'm going to say a prayer for you. You know, the Spirit of the Lord is telling you that what this pastor is telling you is the truth. You know, he's convicting you. And you're not watching this by accident. You're not listening to this by accident. This is the knock of God. This is the call of God upon you. And I'll say that prayer. Just say this short prayer with me. Short prayer, and things will turn around. Say, Dear Father, I thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for my sins. Say, Dear Jesus, forgive me. I receive you today as the Son of God. Write my name in the book of life. It says, say, Jesus, be my Lord and my Savior. Forgive me for my sins. I accept you as the Son of God. In Jesus' name, amen, 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 amen. My friend, there is a strong anointing upon me, and I feel the presence of God in the studio. And I want to pray for, you know, people that are watching me. You know, maybe you're going through a situation, maybe you're going through a sickness or whatever it is. You know, there's this, you know, the power of God is upon me now, and I just want you to believe. And I know that God is reaching out to you right now. Dear Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I pray for every listener, that person that is watching me right now, that was going through pain, you know, whatever the situation, oh Jesus, I pray for them right now. I pray healing in their life. I command and I rebuke that sickness to go and leave their bodies in the name of Jesus. Lord, that person that is watching me that is bound by the spirit of alcoholism and drugs, I rebuke that spirit in the name of Jesus. I command your healing virtues to go forth and to touch their heart. Let your peace that passes all understanding come upon everyone. I pray for your peace, O God. Lord, bless your children. Touch their hearts. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen, 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 amen. My friend, I know this is a special time. Stay encouraged. God loves you, and he has not let you down. He will not let you down. Hold on to him. I'll see you next week. Be blessed. In Jesus' name. Amen.